And so I'm, a conspiracy expert. I believe in a lot of true conspiracies, but this is not one of them.
Okay.
Except for this fact. Except for this fact. I don't believe that the Secret Service team there was involved in any way whatsoever in doing this.
And that's what you're implying as far as conspiracy concerned.
That's right. However, that does not say that the deep state was not programming this guy
Right.
to go and do it and do an attack, because there's only two ways that these false flag shooting events occur. Either they're a mind control person who usually starts with going to a psychiatrist for some instability, and that psychiatrist is tied to the CIA, gives a call to the agency and says, here's a potential patsy for you. And then they proceed to train him, like they did Hinckley, who shot Reagan. He disappeared for 2 years before that. His parents don't know where he was. He was under conditioning, I think, by the CIA to do that. Or the other thing is that Satan has a direct relationship of influence with people. And every person who does extremely evil acts does have satanic influence, powerful influence.
But you say you don't discount that there could be what, maybe MK Ultra involved in this, or maybe not somebody that was raised in a dump, but sought after later, someone that was a dysfunctional kid at school that maybe they could have used. What do you think about that?
Well, I'm just saying that totally unnatural.
Okay, folks, welcome once again to Brother Joel Skousen. He is a political scientist, an American author, a survivalist expert, raised in Oregon in the United States of America, and a pilot. Are you still flying right now?
Oh, yes, I still fly every week.
Every week, like what? Like a little Cessna?
It's a Turbo Mooney. I commute to St. George.
Oh, okay. Good. Good. I had a cup before we get started. I had a couple people ask me if you still do the strategic relocation stuff.
Yes, I still consult regularly with people on strategic relocation. I recommend they read the book first. My rates are $90 an hour, so it saves them a lot of money if they have narrowed down their choices and need particular help.
Okay, interesting. And if you guys want to know what that is all about, go to the website,
DoleSkousen.com.
yes, absolutely. The we oh I always want to call it the Week in Review. What
The
are
world affairs
the
brief.
World Affairs Brief? What was the Week in Review? I think that was a program from a long time ago.
It was, yes.
Okay, Joel. It's on everyone's mind. Let's talk about the assassination, well, the assassination attempt of Donald Trump. What are your feelings about that? And is this conspiratorial?
Well, there have been a host of conspiratorial theories put forth about the assassination attempt, especially surrounding the lack of response from the Secret Service and the local police, county police forces in Butler County, after having noticed and put this guy on a suspicion list for over an hour before the actual shooting. And that, of course, has led to, many, many, many claims. So in tomorrow's
Wait,
World
wait, wait.
Affairs
I'm sorry.
Brief.
They were vetting this. Is this new news? Were
No,
they?
no. This has been out for several days now about how many. First of all, he went through the metal detector security to get into the venue. That's where they found his range finder. It's not a scope range finder attached to a rifle, but a handheld range finder. They didn't confiscate that. They didn't interview him, but they took note and put him on a list as a suspicious person.
That was before the shooting actually took place.
That's right. And then he went out of the venue because he had nothing other than the range finder even to question him about. He went out of the venue and then started to scope out the exterior of those buildings. And he was noticed by police. He was photographed at least once. He went in and out. Went to his van, got a backpack, And that is suspicious, people having backpacks they try to go through. But he wasn't going through the venue with that backpack, so they didn't detain him for that. And then he eventually, and I think his van was parked in the rear parking lot of the APR building, which is where the shooting occurred on the roof. And when he eventually got out a ladder that he had purchased that morning from Home Depot, they said it was a 5 foot ladder. I think it's they only sell 6 foot or 8 foot ladders. But in any case, that could get in the van. He put it up and got on the roof. And that's when bystanders started to notice him crawling on the roof. And the conspiracy theories, of course, you know, range around the fact that the first red-haired fellow with a MAGA hat waving his arms and pointing at him and said, there's a shooter on the roof and he's talking to police. He doesn't tell the BBC interviewer what the response was, but the police did respond. They, first of all, checked around the building superficially, didn't see anything. And then the county manager was interviewed and gave the whole story of what his police response was. He said, one of my officers boosted up another officer to reach the roof, pulled himself up with both hands.
Right.
Nothing to hang on to. He sees the shooter and the shooter points his rifle at him and he obviously can't pull his gun or a radio out. He just drops back down and actually hurts his foot in the fall. Then he and that officer who boosted him up get on the tactical channel to which the Secret Service is listening and all the other police and report shooter on the roof, shooter on the roof. Now, then the interviewer asked the county manager, he says, well, what time frame, how long was it between they made that call on the tactical frequency and the shooting? And he said, being that he wasn't there, he said, I don't have that information. But it couldn't have been long. It couldn't have been long because obviously the shooter, knowing that the police had observed where he was going to have to shoot rapidly. And that may have attributed the fact that he wasn't as accurate as he might have been if he was rushed. Now, the other question that has arisen in this is the $64,000 question, is that a video surfaced of the two Secret Service sniper team, the team that was on the building right behind Trump's speaking podium, clearly visible. And it shows those snipers reacting when the shots go off. It sees them, first of all, looking through their scopes in the direction of where that building is, where the sniper was. And so everybody assumes, hey, you've got them in their sights. And then three shots ring out towards Trump and they duck and showing surprise at this. If they were part of a scheme, you know, too, they probably wouldn't have shown that kind of surprise. Then he looks up.
That's a good point. That's a really good point.
If he looks up above his scope, then, to get a wider view. Now, as a former Marine and shooter myself, I know that in a scope, depending on the range and the distance, you only see about a 10-foot circle. He's probably trained on the wild man waving his arms and pointing at the guy on the roof. We don't know what they were looking at. And that's the big question. Did they have the shooter in their sights or did they not? And but in any case, the camera that's photographing the snipers then goes to Trump and you hear five more shots or so. You don't know whether that's the shooter shooting additional shots or the snipers responding to the shooter. But this leaves everyone to a huge conspiracy about, you know, whether or not the government was involved, whether it was a stand down order. In fact, Hal Turner, the convicted FBI informant for conservatives, he acknowledged in the court proceedings that he had been hired by the FBI to infiltrate conservative groups. Well, he's still operating after he got out of prison. And he posted an anonymous post by a guy who said, my name is Jonathan Willis. I'm the top sniper that you see in the video. And I had the shooter in my sights for 3 solid minutes. And the Secret Service refused to give me permission to fire. Well, that to me was suspicious in the first place. If you're going to give your name in a post and you do it anonymously, why not do the post in your name? It seems clear that this is a false flag post. And nobody can check on whether the name is valid or not because the Secret Service doesn't tell who's on their teams. And they won't ever release those names.
Mm-hmm.
But it turned out to be a false post because yesterday, I got the information from Amin Griemer, who's a European who's now a U.S. citizen, a history professor. And his specialty is maps and history, and he did a map of this site, which proves conclusively that the snipers could not see the shooter. And I thought, now this is fascinating. Because even though the scopes were trained in that area, they couldn't have seen the shooter, because he shows that there's a huge tree in front of that building between the snipers and that building. And the sniper crooks had crawled up in the shadow of that tree so that the snipers couldn't see. And then he crawled to the side so that he could just barely see Trump to shoot at him. But the snipers still couldn't see him because he was behind their tree. Okay. This is dramatic proof that the snipers weren't part of a hold your fire, because they couldn't even see it. They could see what was going on in the field. They
in other
could
words, see something similar to maybe what happened to Kennedy, where the Secret Service were told to back off of the vehicle.
Well, that's a true conspiracy.
Right, the Secret, right. And I wanted to ask you about that in a minute, but go ahead.
A couple of Secret Service men stepped off the vehicle to be out of the line of fire. They knew it was coming.
Everything seemed normal. That is, up until this instant. What took place is so odd that we're going to examine the scene four more times. Watch the left side of your screen. The arrow points to Agent in Charge, Emery Roberts, as he stands in the Secret Service follow-up car and motions with his hand. What he is doing is calling away the president's two most important bodyguards, the bodyguards whose job was to protect the president's back by riding on the bumper of the limousine throughout the motorcade. Watch again as he stands and orders the agents running at the rear of the president's car away. Watch the confusion inside the follow-up car that results. Watch the right side of your screen. The arrow points to one of two agents whose job was to hop aboard the bumper and act as human shields. He's obviously perplexed. Watch as he shrugs his shoulders three times in dismay, each shrug more dramatic than the last. As you watch this scene for the final time, ask yourself, is this the kind of conduct you would expect from an agency that routinely sends an advance team to a city a month or more prior to the president's arrival in order to make preparations? Now ask yourself if the assassination could have taken place at all had those men been on the bumper during the motorcade. This is the rear of the presidential limousine. The back bumper is specially designed with a platform on both the right and left sides. There are also handrails on both sides of the trunk. This is where the agent should have been to provide the president even minimal security. The president, unaware of the treachery behind him and the danger waiting for him ahead, continued on to his death. You are about to see segments from three of at least four films shot in Dealey Plaza of the assassination. The fourth was confiscated by the FBI and has never been released for public viewing.
But this does not appear to be the case. In addition, it's very difficult to co-opt or bring into a conspiracy not only professional snipers in the Secret Service, but the local police force as well. It's
right.
One thing to have a conspiracy within one organization, but then to co-opt all the local police force, very, very unlikely. And
this would have had to have been planned for a couple of years at least.
Well, these things are complex. And but in fact, there were other sniper teams. There was only one official Secret Service sniper team, and those are the one visible in the video on the highest part of the roof behind Trump. Then there was another team provided by the county to the right of Trump's sign. They're the ones who actually shot the shooter, because when what happened is, after he shot at Trump three times and Trump ducks down, He ducks down, and now he's obscured from the sniper's view by a big black speaker box that's to the left of Trump if you're looking at Trump speaking. So he moves out of his cover from the tree slightly to the right to get a second, another attempt to shoot, and that puts him in the view of the long sniper team that shoots him. So the Secret Service sniper team that you see in that video never did get a shot at him because they could never see him. But when he moved to the right on the roof to get around the black to see Trump pass it, to see if he could get another shot, that's where he exposed himself, and that's where he was finally shot. And so I'm, a conspiracy expert. I believe in a lot of true conspiracies, but this is not one of them,
Okay.
except for this fact. Except for this fact, I don't believe that the Secret Service team there was involved in any way whatsoever in doing this.
And that's what you're implying as far as conspiracy concern.
That's right. However, that does not say that the deep state was not programming this guy
Right.
to go and do it and do an attack, because there's only two ways that these false flag shooting events occur. Either they're a mind controlled person who usually starts with going to a psychiatrist for some instability, and that psychiatrist is tied to the CIA, gives a call to the agency and says, here's a potential patsy for you. And then they proceed to train him, like they did Hinckley, who shot Reagan. He disappeared for 2 years before that. His parents don't know where he was. He was under conditioning, I think, by the CIA to do that. Or the other thing is that Satan has a direct relationship of influence with people. And every person who does extremely evil acts does have satanic influence, powerful influence. We have to.
Let me say this real quick.
Yeah.
I like how, I just want to point this out. I do admire how you don't separate the spiritual unseen world from the physical NWO players. You say, well, what's the difference? There's no difference. In other words, Satan's involved, period. Whether it's on the spiritual side of it or the physical side or both. Go ahead.
And ultimately, towards inspiring and even revealing himself and promising immunity to the people who are running the globalist conspiracy at the very top, not the lower and mid-level people. They don't get a seance with Satan at all. But the Faustian pact is very real in the world, and Satan does have revelatory powers to his side of the spiritual spectrum. But we're all subject to conscience. It's that receptor in the mind that receives both inspiration from God and temptations and inspiration from Satan. And you have to learn to distinguish which voice is talking to you and distinguish it from your own voice. And it's difficult to do because everything that comes into conscience comes in your own diction, your own syntax. It sounds like you talking to yourself, but you can distinguish. I mean, the voice of the Lord is always after you to improve, to pushing you, to warning you. And it's not all positive. And Satan is giving the calming voice. He's giving the temptations. He's aiming things at your innate set points and your weaknesses to conform to those. So his is the comforting voice. A lot of people think, well, Satan's after me. I'm going to feel this dark, brooding thing. Well, that's only at the more advanced stages when you listen to his voice. But up front, he's the one with the comforting, soft, unconditionally loving voice,
Yeah,
not God. He's pushing, God's pushing you. He wants you to change. He wants you to improve.
I wanted to ask you, okay, so let's go. You were talking about, you brought up a good point, and I kind of knew that you were going to go into that just because you don't think that there were men and women gathered to conspire against Trump in the Secret Service, because that would be hard to coordinate that with local police, because we know that's why they're trying to take the local police down. That's why they've been trying to defund the police for the last couple 5, 7 years, because local police will be there when the feds come after us. But let me digress off that. But you say you don't discount that there could be, what, maybe MK Ultra involved in this, or maybe not somebody that was raised in a dump, but sought after later, someone that was a dysfunctional kid at school that maybe they could have used? What do you think about that?
Well, I'm just saying that whatever someone does, an evil act like this is totally unnatural, even for a liberal kid like this who's anti-Trump. And you know, there's posts on his TikTok where he says, "I hate Trump people. I hate, you know, Republicans," even though he is a registered Republican. His father, by the way, is a libertarian and his mother's a Democrat. So he obviously had a lot of political arguments mm-hmm. in the household. In fact, they're both certified counselors. And I don't trust many counselors, frankly, because they don't understand two crucial things about human behavior. That is spiritual innateness from the pre-earth life, the set points that make us, our personalities relatively rigid. And number two, the influence of Satan through conscience. They don't understand that and they don't know how to treat that. But in any case, they called the police that morning and warned them that his son was missing. Now, they didn't say he'd taken his father's AR-15 rifle, which would have alerted the police to the fact I better call the Secret Service. But I think they knew more than what they were telling the police, and they simply tried to report him as missing so that they would be covered if he did anything rash. But I think because of his anti-Trump rants, even at home, that they knew that rifle was missing and things that he might be going after the president. So I think they're partially guilty. But then again, remember, they only gave the kid's name, but the police on the actual grounds who had taken pictures of this guy, who, by the way, it's not like the picture you see in the media. It's got long hair. He's really gone downhill from his clean-cut original environment. And but they didn't have a name for this guy. They didn't stop and detain him. They had a picture, but the parents didn't provide a picture, a recent picture, to the police so that they could trace it. So I don't even think this report, you know, got traced to the venue itself.
Okay. So what about, do you think there was MK Ultra involved in this?
Well, MK Ultra is an older program that we don't know to what extent. We don't have any recent whistleblowers talking about its current use. MK Ultra essentially was, you put young children under severe abuse. And oftentimes it was the children of conspirators within the globalist deep state. They would give their children over to the satanic right. rituals and other things. It has to do with satanic ritual abuse, sexual abuse. They so warp the mind that then they become malleable in some way to do work. And it has to always be involved with hypnotism. And I'm a real opponent of ever subjecting yourself to hypnotism. Anytime you yield your spirit, you yield yourself to some other force, you're courting dangerous. I remember as a young kid in grade school in Oregon, where the teacher brought in a hypnotist on a stage in the auditorium and asked for volunteers to come and be hypnotized. And I immediately felt, probably no more than 12 years old, I immediately felt nervous feelings. Don't do this. And it's always been confirmed to me since, because I think when you yield yourself, you yield to satanic influence. And that's why in false ritual abuse, people have memories implanted in their mind after hypnosis that turn out to be absolutely false, but they've got a real memory there now because they submitted to hypnosis. Satan gave them a memory. They think it's now real, but it's been proven false. Like a father that was accused that wasn't even in town at the time. He was on a business trip, couldn't have done the ritual abuse. So you have to be very careful about any evidence that comes out with hypnosis.
Right. When you were talking about some of the deep state's own children, I thought about, do you remember the Podesta paintings?
Yes, yes.
Very, very disturbing. I thought about Anderson Cooper, where someone says, is that Anderson Cooper hanging there in the swimming pool? You know, there's a picture of a very sickening, my friend. Yeah. Well, if you look at Anderson Cooper's, I got to be careful probably, but his parents, they were very, apparently deep state-ish, influential. Gloria Vanderbilt
and
Wyatt Cooper. But I don't know. It's something to think about, but to let my audience know if they're like, what is he talking about? Could you explain a little bit what I'm talking about?
Maybe. Well, there are many, many people who have made it big, wealthy, and famous in the world, who have made their pact with the Satan. A lot of rockers, you know, hard acid rock type people have admitted, you know, that they made a pact with Satan, and he makes good on it. I think Andrew
Bob
Lloyd
Dylan. Webber, Bob Dylan said.
Bob Dylan is. I think Andrew Lloyd Webber did. Got all that inspiration about the Phantom of the Opera, which is pure satanic. The dark side, come to the dark side, you know. Oh, it's just beautiful music. That part of that was plagiarized, they claim, by Lloyd Webber. But I think a lot of it was inspired, beautiful stuff from Satan that made him famous. And, you know, you can tell by his Jesus Christ Superstar, what blasphemy against Jesus Christ to put it in a rock motif. It's in a, conservatives have to wake up to the fact that there's real systematic evil in them.
I guess the reason I'm asking about MKUltra, and that might be an outdated term, basically, is what you're saying.
It was a real program in the past, but we don't know if it's being used.
If it's being utilized today. And we're a little bit more sophisticated. Like you said, you know, we're past the Freemason stuff. We're past a lot of the old fraternal organizations that used to have, you know, they're movers and shakers tend to evolve and branch out, and you have new generations being born. And the things of Planned Parenthood back in the 1930s, you know, the narrative changes or the agendas change, but they're always evil. Let's talk about, for instance, I had a couple people wanting me to ask you about you're familiar with the Illuminati card deck?
Vaguely.
Okay. Well, one of the cards, let me look at this for a second. One of the cards is a charismatic leader, and the card features, and we can laugh at this and you know, laugh it off, but the card features a blonde headed figure addressing a crowd of supporters, which some believe bear somewhat of a resemblance to Donald Trump. But you have always said that you don't feel that President Trump is psyops, or that he is, you know, that secretly the left truly loves him and he's playing a part, or maybe not loves him, but that he's playing a part to create dissension. I don't believe that. I believe that he is, like you said, trusts people, and he's, And some things that look like they are conspiratorial, they can appear to look that way, are actually not. And it's just life going on.
Well, my explanation, of course, is that Trump, first of all, he's not a disciplined person. He's a shoot from the hip. He hardly prepares. He lives by briefings. He does no homework himself. He was never a conservative before he ran to president, running on gut feelings, which are pretty good about make America great. But he has no arguments to back up. He has no arguments to contest his worldly advisors. And he's got bad judgment, and he's highly manipulable. He can be flattered, just like he dishes out flattery about Hillary Clinton, great person, and other things. And I mean, he's just all over the map. You cannot make a puppet in a sophisticated conspiracy out of a man who's a shoot from the hip person who will not do his homework, who won't memorize the script. He's just not the kind of material. And you don't attack a true puppet daily, nightly, 24 hours a day for the past 6 years. You treat him like George W. Bush, who was a puppet president, you never really criticize.
That is a good point. That's a very good point. Why would they treat Bush? And I know
with
what you're saying.
With kid gloves, you know, with right. Kid, especially about 9/11, you never heard any real criticism of Bush being the puppet president or reading a children's book, you know, while 9/11 is going on. Of course, it was Dick Cheney, you know, his handler, who was the real Darth Vader of that administration, who had grown his vice presidential staff to over 600. He was controlling every aspect of the government. Yeah. Bush was simply reading magazines and saying what they put in front of him as a script. But Donald Trump's not that way. He, even though he's not dumb, but he doesn't do his homework. And you see, he doesn't have any savvy or argumentation, but he's also very bullheaded. You can't hardly get Donald Trump ever to admit he's wrong. I mean, he was obviously wrong when he thought Kim Jong-un was his bosom pal, buddy. He thinks that I can, with one phone call, I can call Vladimir Putin and get rid of the war on Ukraine, and I can stop World War III with Xi Jinping. He's just a fool. He doesn't understand systematic evil any more than he understands when he said in an interview, I don't relate to repentance. He ought to. Cheated on every wife he's had.
I know. He wasn't. Right. Let me switch gears here for a minute. Let's go to Biden, because this is all kind of related. Why do you feel that the left or the deep state, have they given up on Biden, or is this, in other words, is this an accident? Did they feel that they made it like, oh yeah, this guy is going senile, or did they know all along that was this their plan to have him kind of bow out later and maybe somebody else come aboard? And then I have two more questions after that about that.
Well, first of all, this was planned from the very beginning when they ran Biden, because anybody that you have to sit in your basement and you don't allow to go out and campaign, even in your first run for presidency, you know, has problems that you can't present or put forth in the public. And so there has to be a reason why they chose. Now, Biden was the vice president, so, you know, that is the heir apparent, apparently. But, you know, nobody thinks that Kamala Harris is going to be the heir apparent of Joe Biden. She's just an idiot, a giggling fool who slept her way to political power. But Joe Biden has deteriorated significantly. They may or may not have known about this, but the fact that they continue to push him despite, there's now a rift between the Democrats. Remember, it used to be taboo in the media. You never criticize Biden. You never show one of his lapses of mentality and comments of blank stares or any of his missteps on television. Only the alternative media would do that. And yet, after that debate, when the CNN panel dared to mildly criticize it, it opened up a floodgate. Everybody watching, the Democrats, said, oh, the taboo must be off. We must now be free to express our views about it. And they began to just, it was an avalanche coming forth. We need to replace Biden. And it's got even worse now. After the COVID thing, and he's retired from this, and I mean, he got COVID again. And I mean, he's just extremely weak. And I don't know, frankly, how the deep state, which is obviously wanting to circle the wagon and continue to promote Biden despite all this, I don't know how they're going to pull it off, because it's becoming a wave, a tsunami of calls for him to be replaced. But as I proposed 2 weeks ago on my World Affairs brief, it's a dark theory, but I suspect that they targeted him for assassination, not before the election. They didn't want to promote Harris as the president-elect or president by default. I think they were wanting to elect him, steal the election from Donald Trump, and then kill him with a supposed disgruntled Trump supporter.
Mm-hmm.
This assassination attempt has thrown a monkey wrench into that.
Mm-hmm.
Because now you have to beef up the security. The Social Security has already been totally discredited, especially, you know, Ms. Cheadle, the woke diversity chief who's in charge, who put all those women on his team. And you know, if there's any conspiracy involved, she may well not want to protect Donald Trump very well. But boy, she has had to pull back. And you notice that the RNC, Republican National Convention, he had 20 male, and there was not a woman Secret Service agents in the lot. So she's having to recoil. In fact, she was walking around with her Secret Service protecting her from reporters and any senators who wanted to talk to her, confront her about her situation. But what I'm saying is, the deep state, if they continue to push Biden despite all of this, I think it's a perfect setup for a martyrdom of a president that they can blame. And you know, Biden called for gun control after this assassination attempt, and it's going nowhere. But if you kill a real president, course, he really isn't a real president. He was the president of the stolen election. But if you kill him and you blame it on a Trump supporter, and you do have a controlled patsy that has a social media history of anti-Biden posts, et cetera, or pro-Trump posts and things, then you could very well get gun control, and you could demonize the MAGA Republicans forever. This would be Republicans' worst nightmare. But now I'll tell you very frankly, I think any Republican who can't see that the Republican National Committee has really gone off the deep end and is showing its deep state colors by how this Republican National Convention is handled. I mean, to put a Satanist, Amber Rose, up there, even though she's praising her, I was wrong and Trump is really for us and all that, I mean, this is just stupid. And they're putting Hulk Hogan up there, and they're putting every other politician up there that, you know, wants this.
What is this, 1985?
This is just embarrassing. And then Trump, to show extremely bad judgment, chooses J.D. Vance as his vice president. Now, this guy has got a...
Yeah, how do you feel about that? Okay, so that was my other question. What did he say about the assassination attempt? And tell me what your feelings are about him.
That
in general.
Is an important what he's saying. He's playing super conservative pro-Trump now. He was a never-Trumper, you know, over a year ago. He was a never-Trumper. He has been. But the key thing is that he has a history of promotion that never happens to true conservatives. I mean, you write a book about the hillbilly guy, and it turns into a movie with Ron Howard, and he gets promoted this and that. He gets all this money from Peter Thiel and other of the new Silicon Valley.
All
this
bad.
This never happens to a real conservative.
No.
Who understands conspiracy.
And I thought Trump would have learned from his last administration.
He never
learned. To get never Trumpers that change their mind.
The only thing Trump realizes when he does get betrayed is, oh, suddenly I got a deep stater in my administration. But then when he goes to replace him, his deep state advisors give him another deep stater, like Christopher Wray, to replace James Comey. I mean, this is what happens when you have a president who doesn't know the history of conspiracy. And that's one of the reasons why I agreed to run as the president from the Constitution Party in Utah and Nevada and perhaps Idaho. Their convention's coming up in August, but it's because, you know, I'm the expert in conspiracy.
How hard would it be for you to reach Trump? Can you get a hold of him?
Very difficult.
I mean, he knows who you are, probably.
Well, and their staff knows who I am, and they wouldn't let me talk to Donald Trump. They don't want him to be educated in the history
right.
of conspiracy, especially my knowledge of the phony fall of the Soviet Union and the fake Maidan coup, which wasn't a Western coup. It was a communist coup in Ukraine that gave the provocation to Putin to invade. I mean, I know that nobody wants to debate me because I have the facts. But the point is, I'm not going to win the election, but I'm hoping that enough people in Utah and Idaho put me on the ballot or vote for me so that this sends a bigger message to the deep state than if you throw away your vote for Donald Trump. I mean, he's not going to lose whether you vote for me or not in Utah or any other conservative state, but they're not going to let him win, I don't believe. Why should they? They've still got the mechanism in place to steal the election by internet connected computers that they can change the tabulation anytime, flip votes, make them disappear. They've got algorithms that'll keep Biden ahead if he's the nominee. But whoever it is, you know, let me just say one other thing about the assassinated attempt on Trump. I had said 2 weeks ago when I talked about the potential assassination of Biden that it's the perfect setup, meaning make him a martyr. They don't want to make conservatives a martyr. That's why they did a shoot with a 22 at Reagan. They didn't really want to kill him. They didn't want to make him a martyr, but they wanted to send a message to him. You stop bucking the powers that be in your university or in your administration. He was very, very cautious about going against them after that point. They don't want to make Trump a martyr, but they have anyway, and it's made him very popular. And one of the biggest problems I face in running for president is that there's so much feeling among conservatives about sympathy for Donald Trump, not only because of the false prosecution over the hush money scandal, railroading him into jail, which is still yet to happen, but this assassination now. They just want to pull the lever for Donald Trump just to send a message, but it's not going to do any good. They have to understand you got to think bigger than just Donald Trump. He's incapable of draining the swamp. They're not going to let him get elected. And, you know, but if they did assassinate him, you know, they could even get past the martyr effect, because there's no heir apparent in the conservative movement, in the Republican Party for them. None. Who would they pick? It would be a huge vacuum suddenly that hardly anyone can fulfill. Nobody has the stature of Donald Trump. I mean, even though it's just all talk, he really doesn't have the ability to fulfill. Nevertheless, he's got a huge stature. Nobody can fill rallies like Donald
People
Trump.
Like his heart, but his heart's
he
not like going.
They like his sentiments, mm-hmm. and his sentiments are general, good, feel good type sentiments, and they're repetitive. But I'm afraid that's what conservatives want. They don't, you know, one of the problems I run into, and I speak to a lot of groups, is that when I regale them with the history of conspiratorial power, it's complex and it's hard to remember. Not anybody, you know, disputes. They all like what I say. It makes sense. But it's complex. And they would rather hear somebody give them a rah-rah speech about family values and other things and draining the swamp and getting cheers than they would hear about the facts that really allow people to understand what it takes to really drain the swamp.
Alex Jones mentioned some conspiracies too about the deep state that had. What do you agree with anything that he's been proposing that might come about because of it?
No, I haven't. He predicted the assassination of Donald Trump, and he's just lucky in that, because he doesn't realize. Even though I've told him on his show, I said they don't want to assassinate Trump because they don't want to make him a martyr. But he said Rand Paul will get assassinated and Matt Gaetz will get assassinated and all these other conservatives. And he's just foolish for that. They don't want to make it obvious that there's a government vendetta against conservatives. They'd rather corrupt conservatives with a J.D. Vance. Now, that's a sophisticated conspiracy. You put a person who you make into a vice president. And, you know, if Trump did get elected, you know, it could be because now their man is in place and they can, in fact, eliminate Donald Trump and have J.D. Vance. That's a possibility, despite the martyr effect. You know, evil knows no bounds, and you've got to understand that Satan has grown and become much more sophisticated than the Illuminati period. He has hundreds of organizations now, so if you take down one or two, he's still got dozens left.
I think the way,
J.D. Vance was an attendee at Bilderberg.
Are you kidding me?
No, I'm not. They don't put people there unless they see them as potential.
And nobody briefed Donald Trump on this, or he doesn't know that?
Who knows?
That's nuts.
Nobody with a conspiratorial perspective is allowed near Donald Trump. And Alex Jones, I'm afraid, is wrong on most things now. So he's not any help. Not that Alex Jones likes to think that Donald Trump tunes him in regularly, but he doesn't.
I think
Fox News.
Well, and even Tucker Carlson said the same thing that Alex did about. But I was also talking about where Alex is the reprisal that might come about because of it, or maybe harming, like you said, President Biden, and making it look like that was
a Trump
MAGA.
Yeah.
You know, MAGA did that. I think also, what do you think about, I think the deep state has given up on Biden. Well, obviously, because he's senile, but they stepped in it big time with him. And how would that look if they cheated with him? They know that no one's going to believe that he's got reelected. Do you know what I mean?
Well, the point is, though, that they may not have stepped in it with him. If their intent all along was to martyr this guy and to blame conservatives and to get gun
control, right.
Then they haven't stepped in it at all. In fact, that's what I'm saying. There's got to be, these people are not stupid. They're not corralling the wagons around Biden and pushing him forward despite all this opposition for nothing. They've got to have a dark ulterior motive. And that's the only one that I can think of. Now, I hope I'm wrong. Nobody wishes that on anyone, but nevertheless, we'll see before the Democrat National, if they continue to push Biden, and especially if they replace Harris as vice president with a stronger person they really want for president, then I think that's a very powerful sign they're going to martyr him after the election.
Yeah, I agree. Hold on. How much time do you have left?
I've got about 12 minutes.
Okay. I wanted to ask you about who might be controlling the narrative in the White House. I think the reason Biden went there to begin with was because the deep state wants to send a message to the flyover states, the MAGA crowd, that no one controls the White House except for people behind the scenes. And the best way to send that message is to put somebody like a senile old man in the White House. Do you think that Obama...
No, they don't want to really send that message. Okay. That's something that people are having to come to the conclusion, and obviously are, because of the facts surrounding this this bumped up puppet. And but it's not a message they want to send. There is an arrogance that we can put even, you know, a dummy as president, and we can elect anybody. But that's a private joke, a private boast among themselves. They don't want to advertise that to the American people lest they make them mad.
Right. Okay. I see what you're saying. Do you think Obama has been maybe working under somebody higher to control things in the White House? In other words,
no. Obama was a puppet. Insiders in the White House said he watched television most of the time. He read his script, but he's much more intelligent than Biden. But he's not controlling the Biden administration.
Okay.
There are other people. In fact, you know, he enjoys his luxury life that they promised him as part of being a puppet. You know,
yeah.
He has millions of dollars of property. He's not getting involved. Although he did come out recently and say, you know, Biden really needs to reconsider whether or not he should resign. That's even Obama hinting that he's getting on the side of resignation. But if that's true, it proves that he really isn't a deep state insider, because only the deep state insiders know what they want to do with Trump, and they aren't broadcasting that to the rest of the Democrats, including Obama.
Do you think that they're Americans that are
oh, yeah,
controlling this? Do you think it's the CIA?
The deep state is worldwide. It started out with the controllers in London, the inner city of London. Mm-hmm. But it spread, and now the center of power is in New York because of the financial and military power of the United States. But there are British and even German and other people who are part of the deep state now. We don't know who's at the very top, and it's unnecessary to know. I know that those are the people who get the revelations from Satan directing how this should go, but they never take a public stance. It's not George Soros or Henry Kissinger or any of those people.
No,
those are
gone.
The public faces of globalism.
Yeah. Let me see. What else did I take? Well, before we go, I would like you to tell us how much is the World Affairs Brief again, and how do we pay
for
that?
The World Affairs Brief is $48 a year, or about a dollar a week. And that price hasn't gone up since the year 2000. So it's about half of what it was before. But I know people are not used to paying for something on the internet, but they ought to know from my interviews with you that my positions are unique. And nobody knows the conspiratorial history like Joel Skousen does. Now, if your listeners want a free copy of what we're talking about today, about my deep analysis of this assassination, including the video or the presentation by Professor Rimmer, which shows all of this, why the snipers couldn't see him until he moved out beyond the trees slightly. They can just tomorrow afternoon, when I get the brief out, click on request a sample at worldaffairsbrief.com, and they'll get this particular issue as a sample.
Nice. All right. Well, I think we'll leave it at that. Is there anything else you want to wrap up with?
Well, things are getting very dicey in this country. And as you have surmised, the deep state is off balance right now because their regular plan has gotten much more complicated, I believe, with this assassination. So we can expect, you know, anything goes. We could expect a change in Biden. We could expect a change in the vice presidency. I am frankly most concerned about Trump's stupidity in picking J.D. Vance. This is a major error on his part. a major error, and it should send people a message: you cannot trust Trump to make good judgments. And so I'll leave it at that, but hopefully people
Well, and
will
he's kind
follow
of
up.
an unknown. I mean, he's known, but he's not. You know, he should have picked like Elon Musk or Carl. I mean, if he's a populist, you know what I mean? On the business side of things, I'm looking more like you want to get everybody on board. Then,
I mean, Trump is even saying he's not going to replace Jerome Powell as head of the Fed. I mean, there's a deep stater if there ever was one. Trump just hasn't got a clue about who's deep stater. And you can't tell unless you know the history of conspiracy, the history of the illegal acts of government. I only know because I know who covers them up. You know,
yeah,
I
you've
know the
known
people
for years,
involved in the cover. Yeah.
Folks, if you don't know, if you've been down rabbit holes in the last several years, you have no, like no one, everyone knows who you are in the conspiratorial world. All the truthers know who you are. I just want my audience to know that the reason I have Joel Skousen on once a month and I enjoy it immensely is because of his knowledge and his wisdom. And there's not one thing that I've never, well, except the Illuminati card deck, but that's kind of a kid's game anyway. But there's nothing that I haven't asked you that you don't have insight on. I would say, or my grandpa would say, you know, that you're smarter than the average bear as far as that was concerned. I was raised by a man that was born in 1916. But,
wow.
Yeah, well, he died, you know, a couple decades ago, but he was a good man.
Well, you know, it takes age to this. You know, a lot of people, liberals in the media, complain about the leaders of the church being in their 90s, but you know, someone who's approaching 80, it takes a long while and a long study of history and living. Not everybody who is age, you know, sees what I see. But if you have insight, if you listen to the warnings of the Lord and the promptings of the Lord, you get pictures of things, especially about secret combinations of power that other people are blind to. And it takes age to do that. You've got to live long enough to see and compare various eras and epochs of history and see the patterns about the deep state moving and their strengths, et cetera. And that's what I have to offer people.
You do. Before you go, just real quick, who do you think, or what do you think the left is going to do with this Biden administration as far as who are we going to see run against Trump, or what's going to happen? Or is this a case of idiocracy where they want somebody like Kamala to be in there and take orders? Could it be Michelle Obama? What say
but,
you?
But Michelle Obama doesn't want to run. I think she knows that she is totally unprepared, that she would be a full puppet. You know, she knew what happened when her husband was in there. She knows that there's dangers involved in being president. She just doesn't seem to want it. She would be, you know, the media could make a real popular piece and promote her. They can't call Kamala Harris. She just is too incompetent. Don't discount Hillary Clinton. She's got wild ambitions. She wants
I was
to
just
still
thinking about that.
Beat Donald Trump. And the Washington Post, when they came out and promoted Hillary Clinton as a vice presidential replacement from Harris, that could happen. So I'm going to be watching that very closely about who they, if they keep Biden at the convention, who they pick as a vice president. That'll be telling in terms of who they really want to replace Biden. Now, it could be Gretchen Whitmer. You know, she's a very evil woman in and of herself, but she's fairly charismatic and good looking. And I could see them promoting her even more than Gavin Newsom,
yeah,
who's got such a reputation as a flaming COVID, pro-COVID liberal that, and a lot of dark background between Gavin Newsom, a lot of skeletons in the closet, et cetera. And there's some other, you know, also Rands in the, in the Democratic Party, senators and other things they could pick. But I think you need to watch out for Gretchen Whitmer and Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, because I don't think there's any other way really to win against Trump unless, I mean, fairly, I guess, unless you have a woman running against him. I think a woman is the only way the Democrats are going to, you know, change the dynamics. One more thing, and that's it. One more thing. Because I just remembered this. A friend of mine who's actually helping me get my teeth fixed. Oh, by the way, when you come on next, I'll have teeth.
And you'll look 20 years younger.
Then I'll look 20 years younger. This is what my grandpa looked like. He never liked to wear his false teeth. This guy used to fish with a bamboo fishing pole. Let me tell you something, just real quick. I remember my great-grandpa going fishing with him when I was 12, and he was born in 1889. Yeah. Okay. But here's my question, and I'll let you go. This bullet grazing Trump, is that a message from God to the deep state, to the wicked?
Well,
in other words, you can't touch this if I don't want you to.
No, God plays a lot of games with this testing earth life. It certainly isn't intervening because Trump is worthy of anything. This is a person who's got a lot of sins, you know, behind his background. But it's also playing games with conservatives, you know, who want to think and believe in a savior, you know, a political savior. And this message from God that we saved him, I don't believe it. I don't think God's going to let him win. I don't think God's going to save the country. I don't think we deserve it. I think we're going downhill fast as a population, the demographics and the millennials and the public education that continues to corrupt our youth and the homosexuality and the transgender and the gross immorality in heterosexuals. And abortion's a reflection of that. You know, as Gary North said, if the Lord doesn't destroy this country, he owes Sodom and Gomorrah an apology. Now, God's not going to destroy the country because the New Jerusalem is going to be built here, and that's going to be the only place, safe place, where people are not at war one with another. So it doesn't look like we're going to end in one happy, rejuvenated, save our country, regardless of who gets elected. We're going to be purged. There's going to be a great division in the church first, and then they're going to be driven into the wilderness by probably deep state requirements of take the new citizenship or you can't buy or sell. And that's how we get to the New Jerusalem. And it won't be by a call out. It's going to be by being driven out because you are understanding secret combinations, because you don't subscribe to the mainstream narrative, because you are viewed as an extremist. That's the lot of those that will be tried to the limit in order to get to the safety of the New Jerusalem.
Well, Joseph Smith did say if. He said if the Constitution.
If the Constitution is saved at all.
That's right. And then others say, well, Ezra Taft Benson said when. All right, let's leave it there. We can go another hour. Right. Thank you so much, Joel. I love having you on the program. Keep coming back. And God bless you.
Thank you. Bye now.
Okay, bye-bye.